Hello, and thank you once again for coming along to EcoViews and News. Today we're going to look for a second week at the issues that Lester Brown raises, in part because we have an extraordinary opportunity here in Cambridge. He's going to be giving two public lectures, not just one, but two, and it's a very important moment, in a sense, for our citizens to get out and hear him in both venues. First one's going to be in Cambridge Forum, and I talked about that last week, you may recall. It's basically a public statement that he's going to make about his biography, his autobiography that he's written. And I talked about that last week, so you can see it up on last week's session. But this year, after 50 years, Harvard has honored Lester Brown, and we're going to celebrate that. Last week we talked about his grassroots leadership and global vision in the Cambridge Forum context, and remember to go along to that. It's on October 30th at 7 p.m., so it's Wednesday evening, 7 p.m. Public is welcome to come. In fact, it's free and open to anyone who comes in the door at the First Parish Church, which is on the corner of Mass Avenue and Church Street in Harvard Square. It's moved from a smaller venue of a parlor room in the back to the larger sanctuary. Over the years, he's built up quite an interest of public to come to these events, and it's not the first time, as I illustrated last week with the talks that he's given in the area. And you can get in touch with those talks, in fact, call them up again through ecojustice.tv. I showed you last time, basically, if you put in ecojustice.tv into your web browser, you'll be directed towards the clearinghouse of environmental course material. And that has an extraordinary wealth of back-taped material of a lot of different kinds for teaching courses on the environment that they use in the areas around Boston, or anywhere actually, can be used worldwide. But if you drag your mouse over to the right, you can see that there are drop-down menus, and this one is called Films, Documentaries, and Visionaries. And if you call it up down to the bottom, you'll get to the entry that's called Grassroots/Global Visionaries. And then there are a number of people listed. And you can see from that that Lester's listed right up there after James Hansen. And you can, in effect, click on his name, and it will call up for you a series of notes about him, and particularly public statements that he's made over the years that have been caught in one forum after another, Cambridge Forum among others, but around the world as he travels, and placed up on YouTube. These are links to YouTube events and sequences. One of them was last year here at Harvard, a thing called the Green Carpet Awards. Called Distinguished Award Winner Lester Brown, and if you search under that category, if you just ask for Distinguished Award or Lester Brown Green Carpet or something like that, or 2012 Green Carpet Awards, if you put it in the search engine, you can find it. And what will come up is the Harvard Green Carpet Awards, a little series that was videotaped from an award ceremony that Harvard put on last year in 2012. It gave the Distinguished Service Award to Lester Brown, MPA 1962. After 50 years of being here, that is, he'd been here 50 years ago for a master's in public administration over at the Kennedy School, and in 2012, in effect, they acknowledged that he was perhaps not just an average graduate of that program, but in fact a very distinguished graduate, and they actually created an award for him, the first ever Distinguished Service Award given to anybody, as given to Lester Brown. It was Angela Crispy, who is the Associate Dean for Administration at the Harvard Business School, along with Jim McCarthy, who is probably the senior atmospheric and oceanographic expert on the Harvard faculty. He's in fact a professor of biological oceanography, but he's been a very active participant in the IPCC process, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and has for years headed up the undergraduate major in climate science and public policy as its senior tutor. And as he summed it up in his introduction, Lester is a metaphor for sustainability. In effect, he's the embodiment of the principles of sustainability. And it's worth listening to the award presentation. This was Harvard's first ever Distinguished Service Award, and it was put together for this event of celebrating its 375th anniversary as a university, as well as celebrating the contribution of its distinguished alumni. Take a look.
How do we go beyond the campus and have a larger effect?
This year, in partnership with the Harvard 375th Committee, it is our honor to present a very special Harvard alumnus with our first ever Distinguished Service Award. This award was created in response to requests from students to connect our efforts beyond Harvard's campus and hear directly from an alumnus who has made a significant difference in the sustainability field. This year's winner is a proud alumnus of the Kennedy School and a prominent voice for interdisciplinary approaches to global scale natural resource issues. His principal research areas include food, population, water, climate change, and renewable energy.
What do you mean, Heather, this isn't like the Oscars? This is definitely like the Oscars.
So this person founded the World Watch Institute in 1974, the first independent research institute devoted to the analysis of global environmental concerns, and the Earth Policy Institute in 2001. Which is working toward an environmentally sustainable economy. Our winner is a recipient of many prizes and awards, including 24 honorary degrees, MacArthur Foundation Genius Award, and recently he was selected as one of foreign policy's top global thinkers in 2010. Described by the Washington Post as one of the world's most influential thinkers, he addresses political and natural tipping points in his most recent book, World on the Edge. He is always looking over the horizon at the big picture, helping us to see where dangers lie ahead. He has been called an environmental Paul Revere. With enormous admiration and respect for his work, I'm very excited to be presenting our first ever Distinguished Service Award to Lester Brown. Lester is a metaphor for sustainability. Please join me in welcoming him to the stage.
Thank you, Jim and Angela. Thank you, Harvard. As I was watching this last event here on stage, it reminded me how much Harvard has changed in the 50 years since I was on campus.
Okay, how much Harvard had changed since the 50 years he had been on campus? Well, in fact, yeah, Harvard's changed in a lot of ways, but it's extraordinary the consistency that Lester has had in the last 50 years of delivering a message to the American people and to the world, well beyond America. His influence now is global, and it has been for decades, and it's pretty extraordinary that Harvard creates a first ever award for distinguished service and gives it to this one individual. In fact, not a former PhD, but an MPA from Harvard, from the Harvard Kennedy School, and it's the business school associate dean that comes over and talks about it. Now, In addition to the Cambridge Forum lecture that he's giving on Wednesday evening, he's going to be talking on Friday. So this year we have both events to look forward to in 1 week. And the talk on Friday, which you're all welcome to go to as well, is in Maxwell Dworkin, which is a classroom over at 33 Oxford Street, on the ground floor in room 115. Be sure to come along to it, because it's an extraordinary event, in addition to the events held last year to celebrate his lifetime achievement. This is an extraordinary event to hear from him about peak water. What happens when the wells go dry? He's thought about this for a while and written about it. In fact, if you look up in the clearinghouse under the category of searching the site, you can just search for Lester Brown and water and get some access to materials that he's presented in the past on this, including an important interview which makes the link between water and the crises that he sees emerging. There are going to be several. This is what the title comes back as when you do a search for Lester Brown and water: How the Battle for Water Will Reshape Our World, Lester Brown. Let's listen to a bit of the interview.
Most people are aware that we're facing water shortages, but not everyone has connected the dots to see that water shortages means food shortages. There are a few commodities that are more underpriced than water. And it's because of the historical situation. At one time, there's more water than we could ever use anyhow in most of the world. As the demand for food has increased, so has the demand for water, because 70% of all the water we use in the world is used for irrigation. So the growing demand for food drives up the demand for water and makes it more valuable. In 2007, we saw world food supplies tighten, and food prices began to rise. A number of countries, exporting countries, in an effort to try to control their domestic food price inflation, restricted export. What happened then was that importing countries suddenly realized they could not depend on the market, as they historically had, because exporting countries, when things got tight, they had learned would restrict exports. So this is when the importing countries began looking for land in other countries that they could buy or lease on which to produce food for themselves. And while we talk about land grabs or land acquisitions to describe these transactions, they're actually also water grabs, because land without water is not very useful in producing food.
Okay, you get that logic. I mentioned it last week, but it's crucial to understand that land grabs are in effect water grabs. The movement into grabbing new territory in Africa for the food production needs of the Indian subcontinent and of China have behind them the logic of a water grab. Water is scarce in growing food in these other areas, leading to the valorization, that is, the evaluating of African land in reference to its availability of water, and it begins to look attractive as an investment opportunity for large sources of capital in the Middle East, where water is very scarce, in India and in China. So behind the dynamic of land grabs in Africa is a movement towards controlling water supplies for agricultural surpluses that can then be exported to these other parts of the world. Very few people have made this connection globally, and are kind of sitting around being mystified of, well, why are they interested all of a sudden in African land? It has to do with water. And Lester's the one who's pointed this out.
Two of the countries that have been favorite targets of these land grabs, Ethiopia and the Sudan. These two countries occupy 70% of the Upper Nile River Basin, and it is the Nile that Egypt depends on for all of its agriculture. It basically doesn't rain in Egypt. And so The Nile River is the lifeline for Egypt. Egypt either imports its wheat or imports the water to produce its wheat. But suddenly, with all these land acquisitions upstream, the amount of water reaching Egypt in the Nile River is going to go down, down, down. And Egypt has no place to go, so it's in a very difficult situation. But variations of this will be taking place, are taking place with the Euphrates River, which is shared by Turkey, Syria, and Iraq, the Mekong River, with China controlling the upper waters of the Mekong, building dams and so forth, which means that the downstream countries like Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, will be getting less water. Food has become the new oil. Land has become the new gold. And so we're seeing this high-stakes game now of trying to see who can find land where. And initially it was national governments doing this, but as more and more people realized that land and the water to go with it are becoming scarce resources, suddenly we find investment banks investing in land. Not that they ever planned to farm it, they're speculating. It represents a growing competition, and it represents a new mood in international affairs of every country for itself.
Yeah, that's absolutely crucial. When banks start to invest in this, they're investing not just in the agriculture production, but in the future prospect of agriculture production. They're in effect speculating. They're speculating because of the new laws passed under the Clinton administration, which repealed the regulations on banks to get into these kinds of things. They're speculating on the potential price of food going up. Therefore, they're buying up land in such a way that allows them to get into what they think will be a higher price. That land speculation is at the base of the food insecurity in the third world at this point. And Lester has been the first to point it out again and again and again, ever since the food crisis of 2008. It's now 5 years ago that he started to point this out as the major source of global insecurity, not just insecurity in one part of the world, because of a bad rainfall or something like that. A bad rainfall or an excessive drought season will accentuate the problem. But what he's drawing attention to is the structural underlying problem of land being linked to water scarcity. And for that reason, being the object of speculative investment on the part of the most powerful institutions in our culture, the banks. It's pretty extraordinary.
The bottom line is world grain prices and world food prices are rising. Grain prices today are double what they were a decade ago, and there's little prospect that they're going to go back down again. The Mayan civilization was very successful. At least 3 million, some think even 13 million people at its peak. But then the 8th and 9th century, deforestation and soil erosion began to undermine the food supply. The individual cities in the Mayan Empire began competing for the available food supply, even fighting over it, and then the whole thing collapsed, and you go there now, and it's all jungle. Now, we think, you know, being in the modern world with advanced technology in the early 21st century, that that couldn't happen to us. But it can.
It would seem it couldn't happen in modern society, but it can. And it will, given the trends that are in place, the institutional trends that have to do with speculative investment on food futures, and the secular trends towards climate disruption. Climate disruption is not just drought. It can be drought in some parts of the world, but it can be floods in other parts of the world. It's the perturbation that climate change is going to bring upon the area. Now, he in fact talked a great deal about Egypt as an example. Basically, the countries upriver on the Nile from Egypt are starting to sell off land and lease land to countries that are using the water on it to grow crops to export to other parts of the world, India, the Middle East, and China. Now that water isn't coming down the Nile to the Egyptians. The Egyptians are hit by another problem, and that has to do with the gradual rise of the seas. Sea level is rising in the Mediterranean, as it is globally, because of climate change. Now, the tragedy in Egypt's case is that two things are happening at once. Less water is coming down the Nile, and sea levels rising in the Nile Delta around Alexandria, where a great deal of Egypt's food supply is grown. The seawater is infiltrating into the aquifers that were fresh water in previous years and decades. They're salinating the aquifers, making it impossible to grow food on the full area that used to be used for food production in Egypt. This is a double problem. Not enough water is coming through, and the water that does come through is competing with rising sea level, such that the aquifers are becoming more and more saline, impossible to use for the production of food. And you have large portions of the Nile Delta population basically facing food insecurity at a time of severe climate change, rising sea levels, and diminished flow of water through the system. Well, this is the kind of thing that Lester puts together as a synthesis. He also drew attention to the Euphrates and the Turks using damming water for agricultural purposes that doesn't get to Syria, and the Mekong River in Southeast Asia. These are the areas that are considered flashpoints by the IPCC and those who look at the social impact of climate change. These three big river deltas are going to be subject to immense perturbation as climate becomes more and more unpredictable and subject to severe weather events, either cyclones or droughts. In this case, we're going to see an accentuated focus on water, and that's what is talk is going to be on Friday. Thursday night, remember, you can get hold of the issue by listening to his autobiography called Breaking New Ground, coming Wednesday night at 7 o'clock in the Cambridge Forum. Come along to that and see how he got into work on agriculture over 50 years ago and how his perspective is matured over that period. Take a look as well then on Friday, November 1st, at his public talk in Maxwell Dworkin, G115. Two talks in 1 week by a very distinguished gentleman. You can catch up on all the background material on ecojustice.tv and note that it was Harvard's first Distinguished Service Award given for the 50 years of work of Lester Brown in this vital conjunction of problems, climate change, water scarcity, and its impact upon future food security for the world as a whole. Keep in touch on air and online as we discuss these things. Thank you very much for joining us.